next hour, we are going to be learning all about how to take care of your teeth. Before we begin, though, I want to everybody comment on my new look. Got 8 inches cut off today, thanks to Erin at Hair by Nicole. So thank you, Erin. And I would also like to, before I thank my crew, which is very important, but I do want to invite you, if you have any questions for this evening, write down that number now, although you'll see it periodically on your screen. You can always give us a call at 781-270-9199. I always have to cheat because I never call. Or you can email me at talk@bcattv.org. If you have a question for later on that you'd like me to forward, if you have a question for me, suggested for a future topic, I love getting email. I would like to thank the crew for this evening. We have Colleen Moore, director extraordinaire, who always gives up her Wednesday evenings to come and help me out. So thank you, Colleen. We have Tatiana Hawkins, who is another volunteer here, who gives up a lot of her days to come and spend at BCAT, including Wednesday night, so thank you. And we also have Kyle Ruffin and Corey McNeil, who are staff members here, who basically keep the place running, so thank you guys. And last but definitely not least, I want to thank my husband Paul for staying home for daddy date night. Hopefully the kids are in bed by now, because they had a long day. So anyway, and now I would like to welcome our wonderful guests. We have Dr. James Kostas.
Thank you.
Who is the chief over at Complete Dental Care, and your soon-to-be new colleague.
Correct.
Or new colleague.
New colleague.
Justin Cardarelli.
Yes, good job.
Okay, I got lucky. So, thank you guys for joining me.
Thank you for having us tonight.
Thank you very much.
And it's a good thing it is after bedtime, because my daughter would be on the phone right now just grilling you on everything that a six-year-old could ever want to know about dental care.
A lot of questions to answer.
Okay, can we start out, like I start out every show, just finding out a little bit more about you, where you grew up, where you went to school, if you want to divulge that information, and what made you become interested in dentistry and how you made it to Burlington, if you didn't grow up here.
Great. I grew up here in Burlington, and am a graduate of Burlington High School.
Mm-hmm. So you knew exactly
a few years ago, went on to Tufts undergraduate in Medford, and then on to Tufts Dental School in Boston, and worked a year at a residency at a hospital in Boston, and then worked for another couple of dentists before I opened my office here in Burlington in 1992. So we are celebrating 23 years here now as Complete Dental Care in Burlington. And
gonna have a big party in 2 years.
We are going to have a very big party in 2 years, like we had a few years ago at our 20th. But in any event, when I was a young child, I always was fascinated with teeth and always was interested in becoming a dentist. I had a less than terrific experience in a dental chair, and I wanted to change the world.
Fix that.
And as I soon found out, as I grew and decided, different avenues to pursue, dentistry became a natural calling, because it marries a lot of talents together, artistry and science and relationships with people. And it's just been a very rewarding career. And coming back home to my hometown was just a real thrill for me to do that.
Excellent. So no plans on moving?
The office, Complete Dental Care, is going to be in Burlington. I would say pretty much my goal is that it's going to be there long, for a very long time.
Forever!
Yeah.
So. Excellent. Great. Your turn.
My turn. Justin Cardarelli again. I'm from nearby Tewksbury, Massachusetts, so not too far, 15 minutes away. Went to Tewksbury Memorial High School, then University of New Hampshire for my undergraduate, and then Tufts University as well for my dental education. I graduated in 2015, so fresh face
like
on the
scene. You just graduated. Came right here from graduation.
Yep. It was not too long ago. Excited to start working with Dr. Kostas at his office. I've known Dr. Kostas for 7 years now. I met him while I was an undergraduate at UNH. Started shadowing him, developed a relationship, found
so
out
So you
that
were planning this all along, weren't you?
It's kind of recruiting, I guess. I don't know. But we found out we had a lot of the same, you know, ethics and morals and a lot of stood for the same thing. So we thought it'd be a good partnership. So I'm looking forward to get started
cool.
there. Yeah. Similar things brought me to dentistry. My parents, my mom's a nurse and my dad's a carpenter. So I grew up, you know, spending time in my mom's, you know, medical mm-hmm. offices where she was working, and you know, I had a hammer in my hand by the time I was old enough to pick it up.
Okay, I'm not
dad.
Letting you near me with power
tools. No, totally different. But I had an appreciation for making something with my own hands, and you know, the beauty that can come from that, and also the real thing. My dad had clients of his that he's known for 40 Ever. Years now, and I really enjoyed that aspect of, you know, being a service provider and making friends. You know, not just having patients, but developing
Yeah, but when you're a dentist, you can't talk.
We can talk.
Yeah, you can talk, but, you know, you have very quiet, you know, one-sided conversations.
It's amazing how much of a conversation you can have
Gotta learn
with your hands
language.
In somebody's mouth.
Yeah.
But
and looking at them upside down.
Right. Yes. And the relationships that you build, it is quite fulfilling. And, you know, ironically, it's amazing how quickly time does fly by, mm-hmm. but a number of the patients that we have in the practice are children of kids who were patients in my practice when I started, and dare I say, it happens fast, and it's fun to just have that relationship go on for many years.
Neat. Now, both of you just expressed the love that you have for your line of work. Now, I remember hearing quite a while ago that dentistry is like supposed to be one of the most stressful careers like in the United States. Do you have any idea like why that is? You don't seem very stressed.
I mean, my experience is a little different just coming through school. School is stressful in its own way. But I think, you know, as long as you can find happiness in what you do, and different people can deal with stress in different ways, he'll know more of the stresses of real-world dentistry, but, you know, my school stress wasn't too bad, and actually the stress was kind of less once I got into clinic and was dealing with patients.
Okay.
I like the person-person interaction, so that's not something that I think would stress me out down the road.
Yes, and, you know, as Justin said, and, you know, you may have in your own, in your own experiences, every career path that people choose, you know, has its own rewards and stresses. The beauty of
not to put you on the spot there,
right? But the reality is, I would say that you know, for me as an individual, you know, dentists tend to be perfectionists, and maybe there's something with that.
The little type A personality type thing,
yeah,
or something.
Correct. Okay. And but the reality is, in the fulfillment you have in whatever career path you choose, if you truly enjoy what you do, you know, you learn to deal with stress, and as everybody does. And I'm not so sure in my personal experience that, you know, I haven't seen that amongst colleagues of mine and whatnot.
Okay.
But
well, maybe I read it on the internet, and if it's on the internet,
yeah,
it's got to be true.
So,
sorry, I digress. Now, flip side of that. A lot of people tend to be afraid of going to the dentist. You guys are friendly guys. Why would somebody be afraid of going to see you?
Well, you know, people don't like to be in a place where they feel vulnerable. And
they can't talk.
And you're in a dental chair, and you're, you know, that is, you know, can be, you know, it's a medical facility, and it can be a scary, you know, you're putting yourself in a vulnerable position. And that's why at my office, we have a number of highly skilled, you know, employees who assist with all aspects of the visit in helping people feel comfortable, and we have a very warm and inviting environment. And I think dentistry in general has addressed that across the board. You know, most dental offices have a feeling of you're going into a familiar place. You know, they're
trying to build that familial
rapport and familiarity for the patient. In the comfort, so that it's more that you feel like you're walking into somebody's, you know, inviting home, as opposed to a cold and sterile environment.
Yeah.
So.
Okay. Now, what are some of you kind of started to address this, but what are some ways of finding a good dental practice? You know, is it by word of mouth? No pun intended. Is it, you know, online? Is it, you know, just whatever your insurance company.
Well, I would say there's an awful lot of information out there, and the internet does provide a source of information for people, and that could be a good starting point to go on the internet and, and Google dentist in Burlington, or wherever you're looking. But then talking with your friends and family and neighbors, I think a personal referral is probably the best way of finding out, where you might feel comfortable. Who knows you better than your friends and family, and they can, refer you to, whomever that that they go to or that they know of. So I would say that makes sense. And then there's credentialed websites like the American Dental Association or the Massachusetts Dental Association.
Is that like 1-800-DENTIST or something, or is that something
else?
Well,
that's different, but American Dental Association, you'll see their logo on toothpaste, and if you Google them or the Massachusetts Dental
it's
Society,
like the seal of approval.
They can they have a list of dentists that practice in a particular state. And you can then, start your search there. But I would say there's nothing like, hearing testimonials or reading testimonials and on the internet or from, your family and friends.
And then
what would
once,
you say, Justin?
Yeah, once you're there, I think it comes down to communication too. You wanna have a dentist that you can talk to and that talks to you.
you can talk to it when your hands are,
Well, even beyond that, like during the treatment planning process, your first appointment, it's not usually, as long as it's not an emergency or anything, it's going to be almost a get to know you kind of thing. And that's like the best way, I would think, to figure out if it's the right place for you. I mean, you can read your reviews and your friends and family, like you said, those recommendations are, so valuable. But I think getting to know the dentist, talking to them, making sure that you feel comfortable there and comfortable with them, because you're going to be working so close together.
Yeah, that's true.
I think that's the best way to do it.
That
first
vulnerability aspect.
Yeah.
Right.
First tangent, I think. You had mentioned, before I ask that question, apparently we do have a phone call.
Wow. Fantastic.
So let's see. Can you hear us?
Yes, I can. This is Greg calling.
Hi, Greg. What's your question this evening?
Well, I'd like to know, are those your two guests, do they do dental surgery?
Well, we're going to be getting to that, but what kind of dental surgery are you thinking about?
Well, I've had three tooth implants, and one of them was a front tooth, which was a perfectly good tooth. The reason why I had to lose it was because the root was cracked below the gum line. And had it gone for a longer period of time, it would have given me quite a toothache. In fact, the dentist I had, when he pressed down the back of the tooth, already I could feel a touch of pain, so to speak.
Okay.
But I just want to put in a tremendous plug for dental implants. I certainly swear by them. I don't swear at them.
Some people might.
I can't say enough about them. And I do know that Winchester, I won't mention his name, but he's a very, in my books, a renowned dental surgeon.
Okay. Well, Greg, we do have a lot of questions to cover, and we will be actually talking about my next question is about seeing a specialist and going into all of that. So how about you stay tuned, and we will hopefully answer your questions.
Okay.
Okay? Great. Thanks so much for calling. Glad you're watching. So, okay, what are the advantages of, seeing a specialist versus letting... Both of you are general practiced?
Correct.
Okay. Staying with a general practice versus going to see a prosthodontist, who was actually a guest on my show a couple years ago. Mm-hmm. So how do you find that division?
Well, it depends on several factors. And I probably the easiest way to explain my answer to this would be that your general dentist is like the quarterback of the team.
Okay.
And there are certain situations that require some expertise beyond the general dentist training.
Okay.
And we would bring a specialist in for that sort of a situation.
Okay.
Greg just mentioned a particular problem with an implant or a tooth that was cracked in a specific way in the front of his mouth. And there's so many factors that go into how do we restore that to make that implant and the resulting tooth that we put in there look like it was your own natural tooth growing right back into place. And sometimes it's best to have a specialist help in that avenue of restoring the tooth.
So, like in Greg's situation, he probably started at his
general dental office. Correct.
Had the situation evaluated and then was referred to a specialist to.
Correct.
Okay. Now, would there ever be a case where you would do a dental implant?
Yes. There are many cases where, you know, your general dentist knows you, has a strong relationship with you, the individual, and there are a number of procedures that we do in our office that you know, take quite a bit of technique and expertise to achieve. Most of what you do in dentistry is a mix of science and art. And, you know, we attend and participate in a lot of continuing education and training to perfect your techniques and your experience. And so there are many situations where knowing the whole problem that the patient is facing, as well as their individual medical or, you know, just emotional needs, it's best to keep it within the same office because of their, you know, keeping their anxiety levels lower and their comfort level with the practices, you know, processes and whatnot. So
just a more familiar setting.
Correct.
Yeah. And I know Dr. Kostas has taken courses to place implants. Me being a little bit younger, I've gone to Tufts and they actually teach implant courses now. And not necessarily how to place them, you know, you still need to do your continuing education courses outside of school to be certified for that, which Dr. Kostas
is. Cool, because that was actually one of my other questions that came up.
Which Dr. Kostas is. But at least we have a knowledge of, you know, when to refer or when it's something that we can handle, and a little bit of a basic knowledge that we can take to those continuing education courses.
Because I'm sure you don't want to go get in a situation where all of a sudden you're halfway through a procedure going, oops, you know, that would not be good.
Correct.
So, okay, so continuing training for relicensing or recertification, or what is the correct terminology?
It's 40 hours, correct? Yeah,
40 hours. You know, all the different medical fields and dental fields in Massachusetts, you know, have to take a certain number of continuing education credits every year, and you renew your license every 2 years, and it's through a series of, you know, coursework and, you know, whether it's hands-on or classroom or, you know, all the different
avenues.
Now,
does some of your practical experience cover that, or do you have to?
No, that's outside of your practice, yes.
Now, are licenses transferable to other states?
That's an excellent question. There is still each, as I understand it, I have not pursued a license outside of Massachusetts.
Because you're staying in Burlington.
I'm staying in Burlington.
You have no choice.
But there is a like a regional board that you can take, and that has reciprocity with a number of states across the country. When I graduated several years ago, it was more fractured, and you had to take a licensing board in several states. You know, it only covered very few states, and each individual state had its own extensive
licensing
requirements.
Well, that's in a lot of different fields other than
dentistry. But it has become more of an umbrella type issue, and then you take a jurisprudence examination for the individual states now.
And they just changed, so when I was going through school, it was NURB or REB, was it? It was Western, Northeast, pretty much what it was divided into. But like Dr. Kostas said, I took the NURB for the Northeast.
Okay.
That would let me practice in Hawaii if I wanted to. It's the
Hawaii
connections.
Nice.
Yeah, I know. Keep my options up. No, I'm staying in Burlington as well. So there's more options now. There's more options now. So the Northeast Regional Board, you know, works in Utah, works in Hawaii, but.
Okay. Now, along with specialists, you know, we talked about, you know, for implants, what about like orthodontic treatment? Because I'm also thinking, you know, with my kids' genetic makeup, they are destined to need braces.
Right.
So do you do any orthodontic work, or do you refer to specialists?
We do limited orthodontic treatment in our office. However, a number of, and that is basically to help the individual who has minor cosmetic issue, usually in the front of their smile.
Oh, my kids.
And they're looking for a relatively expedient way to help make their smile the best that it can be. And oftentimes patients
come to us. Invisalign type?
Correct. Patients will often come to us since they have crooked teeth and they want to have veneers. And sometimes veneers really aren't the right way to go, and just a minor gentle movement of those front teeth to align them better can make, that's all that the patient may need. Or there are some indications where you do a minor movement and then put veneers over better positioned front teeth. So that sort of work we would do in our office.
Okay.
However, someone like your children, who has more extensive jaw issue or malocclusion or bad bite, as it might be called, then we would involve a orthodontic specialist because that will help get the best overall result for the patient.
Okay. And the recommendation now is about 7 years old, usually bring your child to the orthodontist.
Exactly. Really?
Yeah, okay. Kind of interceptively, you know, take the panoramic x-ray, which will give an entire view of the jaw as well as the teeth involved. And that'll let them kind of see what's going on, where the teeth are coming in, what might be misaligned, and what they can kind of, you know, take care of before it becomes too much of a big problem.
Okay.
So around 7 years old was a good time to go see the orthodontist.
So when I bring my kids to your office the next time, you can refer me to,
because
we know this is going to happen. So speaking of genetics, what role does genetics play in teeth in general? Whether it's bite, whether it's, you know, the hardness or, being prone to cavities or...
What do you say, Justin?
I think it's just like anything, you know, genetics. You're going to get certain traits passed down from your mother and your father that you're going to see in the children. A lot of times you'll see siblings even that have the same kind of occlusion, same kind of bad bite like you were saying. So I think a lot of it is based in genetics. Cavities-wise, I mean, what do you...
Well, I firmly believe that, you know, your own home care, and when it comes to cavities, your own home care and your habits, eating, what you eat, what you expose your teeth to, habits that you might have, probably play a bigger role in whether you're going to get cavities in your teeth than the fact of the genetic makeup of your body. Having said that, maybe from genetics, we've seen some individuals who, geez, they do everything right. They eat a good diet. They don't have a lot of sticky sweets and snacks, and they, you know, brush and floss and do all this good stuff. But then again, there's this one child in the family who has a number of cavities on their teeth, and it would seem like probably all those kids are behaving the same, you know, generally speaking, maybe not. But maybe for some reason the makeup of their saliva is such that it's not as protective as others' saliva is. Because we do see some individuals, on the other hand, who seem to break all the golden rules, and then they don't seem to have, you know, show any signs of the problem. So I would say genetics does play some role.
Okay.
But I think that what you do, generally speaking, is probably a bigger factor.
So it's kind of like the whole nature-nurture thing.
Exactly.
You know? Yep. Okay. Going in two different directions here. My next question, not to sound formulaic, but I've been watching too much Law & Order. Teeth are generally a good identifying tool for crime scene investigation. Why?
Enamel is the hardest substance that the human body can create, so it withstands a lot of things. And especially if there's no kind of biological system, like a living biological system in there to, you know, introduce the bacteria, introduce things like that.
Okay.
It can survive for a long time without.
But are they like unique, like fingerprints, or?
Yes.
Well, you know, think about it. Everybody, generally, I forget the number off the top of my head, but a lot of us, everybody has a very unique feature to their bite. So a bite mark is a very, it's a unique fingerprint, okay. so to speak. But beyond that, too, the restorations or movement of your teeth mm-hmm. is documented in dental practices, you know, and for finding missing persons or identifying a missing person that is found, or oftentimes dental records are used because you can look at the restorations that are in that that individual's mouth. And indeed, in the American Dental Association's monthly journal, mm-hmm. they'll oftentimes post records and say, do you know who this may be? Is this a patient in your practice?
As you're talking, I'm like, you know, the FBI has a whole fingerprint catalog, correct. But I don't remember.
Right, but this is very, you know, that's maybe looking for a needle in a haystack, mm-hmm. but people have been identified that way
historically. But it always works on Law and Order.
Well, you know, that's Law and Order, and that's a 60-minute TV show.
48 minutes.
You have to find the answers quickly.
Darn, I just had another question. Okay, well, let's keep moving along because I will probably end up going back to that. Justin, you mentioned that 7 years old is about the correct time mm-hmm. to start thinking about seeing an orthodontist, mm-hmm. should the case maybe. What is your suggestion for bringing a kid to the dentist for the first time?
I think, you know, the first time you want to bring a child to the dentist is between 6 months and 1 year.
See, my kids didn't have any teeth at that time frame.
The other limiting factor is, you know, the appearance of the first tooth. Mm-hmm. Okay. The reason being, it's just a comfortability factor. You want to get them in the office, not necessarily do anything, meet the dentist. You know, the first time you let them sit in the chair, you know, just introduce them to some of the things around them. The next time they come in, maybe they, you know, touch some of the suction or something, okay. just to get them more comfortable with being in the chair. And I think down the road, that makes it a lot easier for the patient, the kid, the parents, and for the dentist too. I think just letting them get comfortable in the environment as soon as possible is very, very helpful in the long run.
Okay, little anecdotal story. I don't know if you remember this or not, but I brought my son. He was probably 3 and a half, maybe. Three and a half. Fascinated with the dental chair and went up and down and up and down the entire time. Wouldn't let him look at his teeth, but somehow you managed to do a full exam while my son is going up and down the entire time. I'm just like,
he just had an assistant lifting his chair up and down to match.
Your chair, it's so speaking of 3 and a half year olds, more familiarity, so the novelty of the chair that goes up and down will be gone by the time the teeth show up. Mm-hmm. Now, just kind of thinking of anecdotal information, my children were over a year when they got their first teeth. Is it more important, or what should a new parent be concerned with? The length or the time it takes for the teeth to grow in, the order that the teeth come in?
Yeah, great question.
What?
The reality is you're not going to be able to really change Mother Nature. Your child's teeth are probably part of that genetic factor mm-hmm. that factors into part of this conversation. And, you know, your child's teeth are going to come in when they're going to come in. Certain situations, because of crowding or whatever, may mm-hmm. be an may be a limiting factor for when adult teeth will come in. The jaw just simply isn't big enough. Okay. You haven't grown enough, and that's when, you know, at age 7, usually your first adult molars will have come in further back in your mouth, and then there's something to anchor to if we're going to do something orthodontically to make the jaw a little bit larger to accommodate the adult teeth that are bigger than baby teeth. And so on. So the reality is, usually, you know, allaying the parents' fears and saying, you know what, there's a broad range of normal Mm-hmm. You read in a book that your first tooth is supposed to come in when you're 6 months old, and you start fretting that it's 7 months, and where's my son's, you know, first tooth?
And my son was over a year before he sprouted a tooth.
And it could go that long, but now he's, you know, he's at the next stage, and we're moving on to looking at that issue of, hey, what are we looking about jaw size to accommodate the adult teeth?
So just another personal freak out that's going through my mind is my daughter lost teeth back in August, hasn't lost any since, but they haven't grown.
Right.
Should I be concerned that it's been 10 months and no new teeth?
In a simple diagnostic x-ray can be done to make sure that there are adult teeth in there, ready to come in, and you know, 9 times out of 10, they will be there. Sometimes there'll be a tooth or two that may be congenitally missing, just didn't form for whatever reason. But as long as those teeth are in there, and they may be taking their sweet time coming in, but they will eventually, you know, erupt.
Because she's now telling me, "Mom, I got another loose tooth." I'm like, "Girlfriend, you need to start growing teeth before you lose anymore."
Yeah. So that's in that broad range.
So just be patient and put all of her food in the blender, because she can't eat corn on the cob.
Right. And bring that up to the dentist when you go in for your checkup, and you know, they'll determine if it makes sense to take some sort of a diagnostic x-ray to make sure that everything is developing the way it should.
Okay. Now, speaking of new teeth growing in, are there any concerns for when or how children lose teeth, like when they're little? Mm-hmm. Is it usually like around kindergarten, first grade, you know, what happens? Because I know there's like a little peer pressure competition going on in my daughter's class going, "I haven't lost any teeth yet." And the other kid already has like all the permanent teeth in. Mm-hmm. So what's the normal process for that?
You want to let it happen as natural as possible. I know like kids, like you said, might be anxious to get those teeth out because of competition or whatever. But the key factor that those teeth that are in there are maintaining space. Mm-hmm. And if you take it out too soon, the teeth that are around, it might close. And you want to make sure that everything, you know, has enough space to come in down the road. I mean, certain situations, you can, if a kid falls and knocks a tooth out, then you can look at sometimes depending on the age of kids, there are ortho devices that can hold that space to make sure that there is enough room for the tooth coming down the road too. But you want to try to let it happen as natural as possible.
So no string on the tooth and the doorknob.
The stuff you see in the movies. I think I might have, you know, my mom, I think, told me to bite into an apple or something when I was a kid to get one of my front teeth out. But just try to let it happen as natural as possible.
Well, it happened in the Berenstain Bears book that I read my daughter last night. So she lost a tooth eating an apple.
Oh, wow.
So let's get back actually into care for your teeth. What are ways, or the best ways, prioritizing, however, of preventing cavities? We already talked that sometimes it's, you know, the makeup of your teeth and your saliva, but what should someone be doing?
So eating a well-balanced diet, limiting sweets, particularly sticky sweets, and certain things that you might think that are good for you, like raisins, you'd say, wow, that's a power-packed snack for my child or for myself. The reality is an awful lot of sugar in dried fruits and, you know, fruit roll-ups or whatever, and raisins and sticky.
But it's got fruit in it.
Terrific. But you know, you have to, you know, be cognizant of that. And if you do have a snack like that, you want to rinse your mouth out as soon as you can, if you can. And believe it or not, the acids can start forming right when you are eating that snack. So you want to rinse out your mouth and maybe give yourself about a half an hour for your saliva to help remineralize your teeth before you go and brush. And that may seem a little counterintuitive, but you wait that time because if you have a demineralized tooth surface from acid, you know, attacking your teeth, from the plaque that's in your mouth, you can end up with, when you scrub your teeth clean, you can end up actually wearing away the enamel a little more rapidly than if you wait half an hour, let your saliva remineralize, and then brush your teeth.
Wow.
And the other factor is brushing for 2 minutes twice a day is kind of the common mantra that you'll hear.
Okay.
And flossing at least once a day. And we like to get children in our office onto the habit of flossing as young as we can after they become dexterous enough to brush well. And we have little flossers, I think they're dino flossers that we have currently, and that gives kids a way to be pretty dexterous and get into the habit of flossing their teeth on a daily basis.
I use the dino flosser sometimes. It's just, you know, it's a little bit more fun.
It's fruit flavored.
Yeah.
No, I'm just laughing about the after they can brush their teeth quick, you know, correctly. Mm. My daughter brushes her teeth so fast. I'm like, did the toothbrush at least see each of the teeth in your mouth? Because it's like, done.
So there is ways of trying to make it as fun as possible, and everybody seems to have an iPod these days or some sort of, you know, some sort of device that they can play a music or a short video on.
Because I even try, you know, sing the alphabet song. Everybody knows the alphabet song. It's not 2 minutes long, but it's longer than what she was doing.
Right. Any way that you can make it more of, you know.
Video dance party.
Correct.
They make the toothbrushes now that will play a 2 minute snippet of a song or something. You get a Justin Bieber toothbrush or something.
No.
I don't know if that'll make your life worse if your daughter gets one of those.
Barney toothbrush.
There you go.
Now, you'd mentioned brush your teeth twice a day. Now, when I was growing up a long time ago, in a galaxy not too far from here, it was after every meal and before bedtime. Mm-hmm. That's four.
Right. Yep. So, you know what?
The number of times,
that's even better. You know, if you can brush, the reality is we live a lifestyle these days that people are on the go, and some folks are out the door 6 o'clock in the morning and they don't see their home again until well after 6 o'clock in the evening. So there may not, you know, there's a level of realisticness that has to be in that. And sure, if you can brush after every meal and before you go to bed, by all means,
but would
you
that
can't
wear
overbrush.
Away your tooth enamel?
Justin,
it's not, it's
away.
Not so much, you can't overbrush your teeth.
Okay.
It's more of a case of you can brush too hard. And that's what a lot of people have an issue for. A lot of people, I mean, my brother-in-law, I've seen him brush, and he has like a death grip. He's a big guy, but he has like a death grip on that toothbrush. And you know, a lot of times recommend, well, that's what, in your mind, you're like, oh, I really need to scrub my teeth. But it's kind of like, you know, I try to recommend maybe hold it with three fingers or something, just to, and use a soft bristle toothbrush, because that's what's going to scrub off. That's what's going to cause damage, you know. And a lot of times you'll see that damage will show up as your gums will recede a little bit, or you'll end up even taking off some of the enamel, and you'll see like little scoop out lesions on the top, like near the gum line. So there's no issue with brushing too much. Just make sure you're not brushing too hard. You know, loosen up that grip a little bit.
Now, you mentioned like little lesions in the tooth. Again, we watch way too much television in our house, but we're seeing like, you know, products that rebuild the enamel. Is that just a marketing ploy, or can that actually happen?
Well, there are, I mean, it's maybe a little bit, it depends on the product, but there are some, there is a number of research studies out there that show that you can remineralize the enamel of your tooth to a degree. So, you know, it's not going to be a miracle cure, but if you have demineralization on your teeth, and that first shows up as maybe some white spots or a little, you know, change in the color of the enamel on your tooth. If you see something like that, it may be possible with some of these products to help remineralize. But keep in mind, what you buy over the counter in a toothpaste usually may not be as strong as something that would be a prescription product that could help remineralize teeth as well. The reality is, prevention is far simpler than treatment, and if you think of prevention, preventing that demineralization to begin with is a far better way of approaching the problem of the beginning of a cavity on your tooth. And proper diet, proper home care.
It's like proactive versus reactive.
Correct. Way better in the long run.
So is that why we have to go see, it's recommended to go to a dentist every 6 months? because I only have to go to my primary care physician once a year for my little health checkup for the rest of me. So how come teeth get more attention?
That's an excellent question. And the reality is, you know, in making a recommendation like that, it gets the broadest brush of the population. There are some individuals who need to get their teeth professionally treated more frequently than twice a year. Okay. And they might have periodontal disease or a level of gum disease that is advanced. They might have to go more frequently, you know, every 2, 3, or 4 months rather than every 6. Other individuals who take impeccable care of their teeth, and you see them at your office and you say, wow, you know, your teeth look like you just had your teeth cleaned yesterday. And they say, they weren't at a dentist for a year or hadn't been in our office because of, you know, whatever happened. So as it turns out, when you're looking at the bacteria that causes gum disease and cavities, that is a biologic organism, bacteria, and it has a life cycle. And the reality is getting your teeth cleaned every 6 months for the healthy individual, that's an appropriate time frame to disrupt that bacteria from causing damage that's irreversible. And so that's how that is sort of developed. And do you have anything you'd like to add to that?
No, I think you covered it pretty well, yeah.
Okay, so there's always the brushing and flossing. Mm-hmm. Is there something else that should be recommended for most people, or just does that kind of cover it?
One of the biggest non-dental issues are, you know, if you're talking about dentistry as teeth and gums, non-dental issue that people come to the office for is they say, doc, I have bad breath. Why do I have that? And that can come from situations where you have cavities or gum disease, but it can also come from the surface of your tongue, which have a lot of papilla, or, you know, a good analogy is your tongue is almost like a deep piled carpet or a shag carpet. Okay. And in all those nooks and crannies, bacteria and germs can thrive. So brushing your tongue or using a tongue scraper and some sort of a mouth rinse, preferably a non-alcoholic mouth rinse, because the alcohol in certain mouth rinses can, in the long term, kind of cause some issues that could lead to some of these other problems. So brushing your tongue and gargling for some folks who have very large tonsils and cleaning out tonsils like that is another piece of the home care puzzle to help treat folks who have halitosis or bad breath. Some of that can be diet related too, but the non-diet, you know, are those factors we just talked about.
Okay. Now, how often should someone receive x-rays? Because there's always, you know, the radiation on your head versus, you know, the advantages of seeing what's going on in there.
I mean, with digital x-rays today, radiation's not as big of a deal as it used to be. The digital x-rays, the exposure rate's a lot lower than it used to be. That being said, the right time to have an x-ray is pretty general. It's when it's needed. You know, if there's something that we think is going on, then yeah, we need to take an x-ray. We need to take a look at that. Other than that, general recommendations are, you know, every year for a fairly healthy patient, and more if it's needed, more if we see something coming up like that.
Make sure your kid has all the teeth.
Right, and an added piece of that is when x-rays are taken, a thyroid collar and a protective apron should be used to protect the individual from the scatter radiation. And using an x-ray tube that makes the beam as small as possible for the area that you're trying to see the information on. And good safe practices. And to clarify Justin's comments a little bit more too, is that as the patient has a relationship, a new patient to the office usually will take a set of baseline x-rays. In today's digital age, we'll often get those x-rays from a previous dentist if it was from a recent visit at a previous dentist within the past year or so. And as you see the level of dental problems in a patient's mouth, they, you know, no problems, hey, maybe you can go 2 or 3 years before you take these scanning x-rays because you now know there aren't problems and things, you know, the you look at the overall picture. It's hard to just pigeonhole. Yeah. Everybody gets this.
Right.
But so when there is a problem, you need to do it just to, you know, getting back to the prevention is far less costly and far more, is far easier and more comfortable for the patient. And so you take a scanning x-ray and you see there's a small problem, let's treat that, and then there's no more problems, we can go out longer on x-rays.
Okay. Now, part of this might relate back to Greg's comment earlier in the show, but what are the stages or the deciding factors when someone would need a crown versus a root canal versus a tooth extraction versus something else? Mm-hmm.
How do you make that decision?
Yeah.
What do you say, Justin?
I think, like we said before, I think it comes down to communication. A lot of it is, you know, there's some cut and dry things in dentistry, but a lot of it is, you know, those gray areas. Okay. It's you know, this tooth is savable. You know, this is the prognosis for it. It has a really good prognosis or it has an okay prognosis. And then you have that conversation with the patient, let them know, you know, these are the steps, this is the cost, this is what we think might happen, but there's a good chance that this could happen. And then you use, you know, the patient's input and your, you know, the knowledge that you give them to make a decision about what to do. Certain situations, you know, if a tooth is like Greg had called, if a tooth is broken severely below the gum line, you know, there's not a whole lot you can do to restore that. You're going to have to do an extraction, possibly an implant or a prosthesis or something to replace that tooth. So again, it's really based on communication. You have that talk with the patient. You give them as much information as you can and help them make the best educated decision for them.
Okay. Now, you mentioned implant versus,
prosthesis,
like a prosthesis. What would that deciding factor be? Would that be a cost thing? Would it be depending on which tooth it was?
Yeah, again, it could be a cost thing. I mean, if you're looking at replacing one tooth and the patient doesn't really want to have to deal with this whole plate in their mouth or something like that, and they have the bone for it, and a lot of factors go into it, then maybe, you know, hey, our best option is an implant. And then you can get into the talks about costs and everything like that. If it's something that you're like, hey, we're replacing a few teeth here, we have, you know, a couple different options, we could do this costs this much, or we could, you could still replace them with implants and get the benefits of the implants if there's a bone there. So again, it comes down to, you know, educating the patient and figuring out costs and benefits and what works best.
Now you mentioned benefits of implants. What are some of the benefits of implants?
A dental implant replaces the natural structure of your root of your tooth and the tooth itself. And that will help preserve the bone in your jaw. It will help people function well and maintain a youthful appearance. And it is the most natural way of replacing a tooth that has to be lost. You know, dental implants over the years have become one of the more predictable treatment modalities that we do in dentistry because the material is some sort of a titanium alloy with then, a ceramic or a zirconium type material attached to that titanium root. You will never get a cavity on any of that man-made material. So if you had the option to save a tooth that was badly decayed, like in Greg's case, maybe there was some way to save that natural tooth. Mm-hmm. You have to start looking at the benefit of, we are now investing quite a bit of effort and in saving a natural tooth structure, which will be susceptible to cracking and decay.
Oh, okay.
And although implants are not foolproof and everything, you know, can have its issues.
Do implants have to be like replaced every so many years?
That's an excellent question. Or? Generally speaking.
I don't mean to interrupt you, but
yeah, but implants,
I'm interrupting again.
Implants have a very high success rate. Mm-hmm. And if they are not successful, it will usually happen within the first 5 years. And most of the of the problems with implants will happen soon after the surgery of placing the implant and within the first year or two. So if an implant is going to fail and need to be replaced, it will usually happen early in that treatment cycle. Once an implant passes a 5-year mark of serviceability in the patient's mouth, you're in a very good zone of highly predictable longevity of that implant. Okay. Now, having said that, implants have an internal safety valve, so to speak, where there might be a gold screw that helps hold the prosthetic, the crown or the tooth that's on the implant root, and that may fail for certain reasons, and that could be usually somewhat easily replaced. So you don't lose the implant, you just have to reattach the crown to the implant. So
I was just wondering, like, if they have a lifespan, probably not the right term, of 20 years or something.
Right, yeah, that's a great question. And in the experience,
because they're not real, they're they're real,
but the reality is, an implant is an artificial tooth root, and it stimulates the bone as you chew on it. Your bone is a living
so the bone
organism.
Grows around it.
The bone grows around the implant, incorporates it into your jawbone, and then if everything is working as it should, particularly once you get past that 5-year time frame, you should be in a good place where things will last a long time. Now, the crown on that, people crunch on ice cubes, people bite on corn kernels that aren't popped. They do habits because we're all human, or they grind their teeth, or they
nail
do
biters.
Things that are that they shouldn't, parafunctional habits. And that can cause your crown or the prosthetic that's on that implant to maybe crack or break and have to be replaced, just like if you cracked or broke the surface of your tooth. But the implant, the artificial tooth root, should be holding strong, and that's quite an achievement.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now we are almost out of time, but I think I have enough time for one more question. We talked about teeth and going to a dentist for oral care. What about something like TMJ, or I've heard that sometimes you can see a dentist to treat snoring, or what are some of the other things that someone might pursue dental care?
Well, patients who might grind their teeth or have jaw pain, or TMJ pain as you call it, there are certain orthotics we can make that can help alleviate that pain by making a cushion between your teeth. And so folks who grind at night or during the day can have a piece that will give them a lot of comfort. In addition to that, dentistry is helping folks with sleep apnea. The gold standard in treating sleep apnea is definitely the CPAP machine and getting that positive flow of oxygen into your lungs. However, some individuals just simply can't tolerate the CPAP. And other individuals travel quite a bit, and it can be a bulky machine. They don't always bring it with them, and you know, lifestyles and whatnot. So there are there's an orthotic that can be made by a dentist, and we can size it specifically for the individual to maximize the airflow. And if you think of the basics of mouth-to-mouth resuscitation or CPR,
jaw thrust.
The jaw thrust,
jaw
the
thrust.
Head tilt, chin lift, and
just
opening
with
the
CPR trainings,
opening up your airway, and using an orthotic that doesn't put you into that calisthenic, but it will actually reposition your tongue to a degree to open your airway to help with the airflow. Now, if you have severe sleep apnea, you really need to be on a CPAP. But if you have mild to early moderate sleep apnea, you may benefit from an oral device to help with getting you a better airway for better oxygenation during your sleep.
Cool.
And sleep apnea is quite an insidious disease out there in our society. And it's not just individuals who are overweight. It's oftentimes athletes who have a neck size over a 17-inch neck, and even petite individuals, women and slightly built men, can have sleep apnea based on the structure of their airway.
Okay.
And just continuing with, you know, other modalities, athletic mouth guards or something. Correct. Dentists can, you know, fabricate correctly. Not the, you can get the boil ones over the counter at CVS, but you're not getting something that's, you know, fitting your teeth in, mm-hmm. in the most comfortable way or the most proper way that they should be set up and set and aligned. So, you know, mouth guards for sleeping, mouth guards for
boxing,
for boxing, for basketball. I mean, that was the first thing all of us made in school, were our own mouth guards so that we could go out and play basketball and not have to worry about being the toothless dentist or having anything cracked.
Ironically, more teeth are knocked out playing basketball and baseball than during football or lacrosse, because mouth guards are more, they're standard at football, lacrosse, hockey, baseball and basketball, not so much.
You could always tell who was the dental student on the court because they'd be wearing their mouth guard.
In fashion color. Yeah. Maybe not. Now, we talked a lot about dentistry changing over the past who knows how many years. Where do you see some of the changes happening in the next 5 to 10 years? Is it, you know, progress in dental implants? Is it progress in X-ray? I don't know.
Right. There is quite, dentistry is going in a lot of different directions. One area that has been out there for a few years is, you may have heard of stem cells, and there are, believe it or not, stem cells in teeth.
Really?
And a good source of stem cells for tissue issues, like, you know, stem cells to help repair torn cartilage in your knee or your rotator cuff or whatever, can be found in your teeth.
Wow.
And lots of kids have some teeth removed for braces, mm-hmm. or they have their wisdom teeth removed. So it's a very easy source of stem cells for you that can be grown out and then saved or stored for potential use in the future, even in the area of maybe somehow regenerating a tooth. Mm. So these titanium implants we spoke so highly of, we can move on to the next phase and somehow have, you know, grow a tooth back. Now, that may be far in the future, but that's research going on
happen.
Now.
I did 2 years of research in that before I went to Tufts Dental. I worked at a lab at Tufts.
So. Yep.
All right. Well, we are just about out of time. So I do want to thank both of you
for
coming on.
It was
lots
really,
of fun. Really nice.
And I'll probably be seeing you in 4 months.
We'll call and remind you.
All right. I want to thank everyone at home for tuning in. Enjoy this wonderful summer that has finally reached us. And have a wonderful evening. Good night.